everybody. This is what Bo's like when we have weather like that. And we've been having a lot of weather like that. Okay, so what I thought we would talk about today is, among other things, occasionally I will get notifications that some of my research has been referenced, that somebody has cited my research. And so I want to show you some things that popped up this week. And let me see if I can share a different video file with you that has to do with that. Okay, so I got a new citation to one of my articles, and it's actually in language. And it's in reference. Language, by the way, is a very prestigious linguistics journal. And the people referencing my work on the copula are actually writing about ASL. My work is not with regard to ASL. It's more general than that. But I wrote about the cycle of the copula turning into a pronoun and vice versa, and they cited me. And then at ResearchGate, they told me that somebody had linked to my work on ResearchGate, and this is the work that they linked to. It was Standards of Proof in Ape Language Studies, the Case of Bo and Literacy. Okay, so those are two examples of my work being cited. One is about general linguistics, and the other is about Project Bo. So I guess what I could do is I could try to screen share with you some of those citations. And we could talk about that. And if you have any questions, you could ask me about that work, okay? So let me see if I can do a different kind of screen share. And at this point, we would share a screen. And the screen I want to share is the second screen. And let's see. Okay. So here is the Google citation to my article that I got. And the authors are T. Sampson, R.I. Mayberry. It came out in Language in 2022. And they're talking about the sign self, which is being used in ASL as a copula. And they say this sign evolved into its current function by way of grammaticalization process called the copula cycle. And they cited my dissertation from 1996, in which I describe this cycle. Okay, so then the other thing was that I got a notification from ResearchGate, where I have some of my articles, and they referenced, they said that these people, so they said that this particular reference, which is not very, it doesn't speak well of ape language research, that this article that was putting down all sorts of work by various different researchers And they reference quite a lot of different people, and they don't mention me at all. But here it says, perhaps the harshest critic, respected semiotician and linguist Thomas Sibbok concluded, and here's a link. So I'm pressing on that link where it says concluded, and you can do that the same thing at home. And when you get there, there it is, Standards of Proof in Ape Language Studies, the Case of Bow and Literacy. So they are referencing me. They did not say that this would go to my article, but they go and they go to a part of my Standards of Proof where there's a discussion about what kind of evidence would it be okay for us to use to prove that an ape is using language. Okay, and we had two examples here, kind of hard to get there, but I can tell you about the story that goes behind this picture. This is a picture of my daughter's sword and a little girl whose English name was Delight and was known to my researcher Eden only as Delight because Delight had been part of our household for a while and then she and her mother had left. And so Eden took this picture of Sword and Delight and Bo and asked Bo when I wasn't there, what is the name of that little girl? And Bo didn't know her. I mean, he knew her as Shinju. And Eden asked him that in Hebrew. And Bo actually took Eden's hand and spelled the closest that you could get to Shinju in Hebrew. And Eden hadn't known that name. So how did that spelling happen if it wasn't Bo who was spelling it? And the other example here is where we had a different intern named Katie. And Katie was left alone with Bo. Katie did not know Hebrew, but Bo insisted on pointing in Hebrew to her. Here's the story about Katie. She had a British accent, and Bo kept telling me that she was a spy and he didn't want to work with her. It took him a very long time to accept her. So when they were in together, he said, Ima lo doda. So mother, not aunt. I think he was trying to ask for me to be there, and she knew enough to understand that. And then he said 7-7. Okay, and in Hebrew, if you spell out the number 7 in letters, it's the same as savea, which means full. And she says, what's 7 got to do with it? He kept 7, I 7. And then he spelled male, which means full. And she thought that he said lo because of the lamed and the aleph here. And she said, Bo, would you like to ask for something more to eat? Bo, you've only had an apple and I've put all this food out for you. And I don't know why you don't want any. Why don't you want any food, Bo, huh? Why don't you want any food? Come tell me. And he started to spell in English because eating app, and he dropped her hand. And she said, do you want to say what you want to say properly? Do you want to concentrate on it? Come on. And he said, because I am full. And she said, after one apple, you're full. And he said, he spelled yes. Are you sure? Yes. So shall I clear the food? Yes. Okay. I'm now going to stop sharing and I will attempt to explain this a little bit better to you. So what happened was the beau was using sort of a pun. So when he said seven, he was actually saying that he was full, because saver, which is, if you spell out seven, sheva, it can also be read as saver. And he was playing a little joke. And there's no way that Katie could have known that. So that's another way of proving that Beau was actually using language. Now, let me see what I can do. I can't see whether anybody's commenting right now, so I'll have to look elsewhere to do this. Okay, so other than Derek, I don't see anybody else commenting on this right now. But okay. Okay, now I can see the chat a little bit better. Okay. All right, so the question is, what sort of proof can we have for something like ape language? Do we have to have statistics? Do we have to have Beau answer an array of questions? Do we have to show that he answered 17 different questions correctly before we decide that something is really happening here? This standard that I would like to introduce is the but-for test. In other words, if Beau didn't do that, how did that happen? If Beau didn't say those things, Beau was the only one who knew that Delight's other name was Chinju. I mean, he wasn't the only one, but he was the only one in the room with Eden when that happened. He was the only one in the room with Katie when he used seven to mean full or sated. Okay? So those are the standards of proof that I was suggesting. And that particular, you know, publication seemed to reference my standards of proof, although it's very hard to understand why they did so. Was it a mistake? it didn't seem like a very respected publication. Okay, yeah, so Lors or Lore S, thank you for your comment. There's a resistance not just to my work, but to anybody's work with regard to ape language studies. And if you've been following Sue Savage Rumbaugh and her work with kanji, that is also very much under attack in a lot of different ways. I mean, there were times where kanji was mentioned, but the fact that Sue had worked with him was completely kept out of the article. So there's resistance to the idea that other animals can use language. And there might be a number of different reasons for that resistance. For instance, there are some people who think that if you have language, if you can prove that an ape has language, then that ape will be accorded civil liberties of the same character that humans have, and they could vote in elections. I personally, that's not my stance at all. I have other people who have suggested that and say things like calling Bo citizen Bo. I'm not going there. There are lots of humans who have language too, and who don't get to vote, and who have guardians. And this depends on their ability to earn their own living and sign contracts. And it's a completely different issue than using language. But that might be one of the reasons why there's so much resistance to the idea that, you know, other apes, including gorillas and chimpanzees and bonobos, have language the way that we do. Well, I mean, Jane Goodall did some very good work when she was young, observing chimpanzees in the wild. It's a different thing. Her job was just to be an observer. She wasn't supposed to actually be interfering with anything. That's completely different from ape language studies. Problem right now is that she's taken it on herself to be a speaker for all chimpanzees everywhere in the world. And she's taken over, you know, she's gotten the U.S. Fish and Wildlife to declare all chimpanzees in the United States an endangered species, when that's entirely outside the scope of what U.S. Fish and Wildlife is supposed to do. They're supposed to be regulating our natural wildlife. Chimpanzees are not natural to North America. They're not a native species, and the ones who are born here are born in captivity, and they are domesticated, and U.S. Fish and Wildlife should have nothing to do with any of that. I don't know that orangutans are smarter than chimps. I don't know why you say that, Derek. But yeah, so no, I got two emails. The emails that I got this week were not strange, you know, they weren't strange at all. One of them was from Google Scholar, and they would just let me know that my work from 1996 was being cited. And that's actually a pretty big deal. And I was very happy to hear that, because, it's quite an honor to be cited in language. And it's kind of funny, I wrote about cyclical grammaticalization, and I wrote about an entire cycle, the copula turning into a pronoun, and then the pronoun in turn turning into copula. A lot of people cite me, but they only cite me for one half of the cycle, and yet they call it a cycle. But nevertheless, I think it's great that I'm being cited. And that's my linguistics work that has nothing to do with apes. You know, it's not about ape language. It's about, you know, human language and the development of human language and how it works. The second one was also, the email I got wasn't weird at all. It was ResearchGate letting me know that somebody, they noticed somebody was linking to my article on standards of proof. The article that was linking to it was very odd, and they linked to it in a place that didn't seem to have anything to do with my work. But nevertheless, they were writing about ape language studies, and mine is an ape language study. Well, orangutans maybe are a little, you know, if you encounter them in the wild, they may be a little bit more laid back than chimpanzees. You know, chimpanzee behavior and orangutan behavior, anything, human behavior, is very much dependent on how they're raised. Okay, and Laura says, I find the idea that Bo can communicate using language fascinating, and it feels bizarre that people would liken it to human rights, et cetera, with advent of people pursuing causes. Yeah, I mean, it's very confusing. You know, I also practice law, and I'm perfectly aware that all of us come into the world without all of the civil liberties that we later get as adults. So children do not have those rights. Babies do not have those rights. People provide for children for as long as they need to be taken care of. And part of that being provided for means you don't get to decide what happens to you. Other people decide for you until it's found that you are capable of making decisions for yourself, taking care of yourself, supporting yourself, and understanding when you sign a contract what that contract means. And there are some people who are never able to do that, and they're human, and they're never free, not really. Derek says, yeah, we have to defend children. We have to take care of children. And even adults, you know, I was talking to a senior citizen, and, you know, at some point, a senior citizen will go into a facility, you know, if they feel they can't take care of themselves. But it's better to stay home, I think, and hire somebody who can help you out. But the senior citizen said to me, but what if I don't want to supervise the person who's taking care of me? And of course, at some point, it's possible that all of us, when we're old enough and frail enough and have diminished capacity, will not be able to supervise our caretakers. But the moment you cannot supervise your caretaker, you are not a free person any longer. You know, that's just part of how it works. Well, the thing you said about seven was actually very creative. It's not like we always think about that. And it wasn't predictable. It's not like any Hebrew speaker would have done that. It was a very creative use of language that Bo chose to use. And he was also kind of testing Katie, because he knew that she didn't know, and he was playing kind of tricks on her, you know, writing to her in Hebrew when he knew that she was an English speaker. He knew he was supposed to be writing in English to her, and he does speak English. He does know how to write in English. But at that time, he was kind of hazing her. So, yeah. Whenever we got a new intern, at first, Bo was very critical of that person. Later on, he got to like them. So he definitely liked Eden. He definitely got to like Katie, too. By the time she left, he missed her. But at first, he was hazing her, and he was trying to fib about her to me. So he told me a story about how Katie had left the door open, and a gang of people with a female dog from across the street tried to drag Bo out of the pens, but Bo was so good, and he stayed, and he didn't want to leave. And he was telling me these stories because he wanted me not to go. See, on the I believe in those days, Wednesday was my day off, and I would go off and do something else on Wednesday, and he would stay with the interns, and he was trying to get me to not go and leave him with Katie. So he told a terrible story about her to me. And of course, at that point, I realized he was not telling the truth, but that's part of his personality at that. And certainly he was very much younger at the time. Bo has good command of language. He can tell stories, he can tell jokes, you know, and he uses puns. Like the thing that I told you the other day, one of the pictures fell off the mantle, and I didn't know why it happened. And I thought, was there a mouse in the house? And Bo told me, no, it wasn't a mouse this time. He said it was ruach, and ruach in Hebrew can be wind. So it could be he was saying it was the wind, but it could be a ghost. I kind of had this idea he was telling me it was a ghost. I think it was actually Summer, my Quaker parrot, who did it, because he's been, you know, he's flying freely around the house, and occasionally he will crash into something. So I think that's what it was. Anyway. Yeah. Well, I think he would be very excited to see them. You know, the question is, if one of the past interns were to return and visit, would he welcome them easily? I think he would definitely remember. I think he remembers each and every one of them. And sometimes I show him videos from the past. I think he would be happy to see them, but he would also probably put them through the test again, because he, you know, he doesn't like to be abandoned. He doesn't like it when people go away and don't come back. So it would be a sort of situation where he would probably test them again, but eventually would be really happy to have them there. Well, I mean, All of the things that we use are words, but in some languages, there's a different word from ghost and a different word for spirit and a different word for wind. But in Hebrew, it just so happens that ruach could be the wind, and it could be a spirit or a ghost. Okay. Yeah. What tended to happen was, after somebody left, Bo would talk about them a lot, and it was clear he missed them. And then he would get angry that they weren't coming back, and they weren't calling him, and they weren't writing him letters, and they weren't contacting him. And then he would get mad. And then after a while, he would stop talking about them. That was usually the sequence of events. Then everybody always told Bo that they were going to come back, but you know, people have lives, and so they never, you know, usually they don't. But anyway, that's pretty much what I had to share. I'll go ahead and share the video again with you. There might be people who missed the beginning of it, and then we'll talk again. And if you have more questions, feel free to ask those. So I'm going to share the video again. This is from today, by the way. It's not a grooming video. I just wanted to show you that we're outside, and the other things that we have outside are the beautiful wild roses that are blooming. And this is summer, and summer likes to groom me too, although I guess if it's a bird is doing that, that's called preening. Here we're actually listening to music by Julia Eckler, and her song is about Tribbles from Star Trek. Yeah, he does apologize occasionally. He has this move that he makes when he apologizes. He actually apologized to me this week too. But you can see all the animals around me. You know, they're all very affectionate. Each of them in their own way. You know, they get used to the household, they get used to the way things are, and you know, not every chicken will sit on your lap. And this is just Bo and me in the inner pen on the hammock. You know, so yeah, sometimes I pet him, sometimes I groom him. Sometimes he grooms me. This is just being affectionate. Oh, and this is milkweed, in case you didn't know. So we're going into milkweed season, and I'm hoping that my deer don't all kill the milkweed. There's this one chicken who always walks alone while the other two chickens are together. So here you see the other two chickens. We've had a lot of crazy weather lately. Bo hates this kind of weather. The wind was blowing so hard it felt almost as if it was going to blow the ducks away. See how they all go together. Yeah, it was, you know, we have a lot of these before. And of course, Bo doesn't like it. You know, the sky turns dark and it starts to rain, and he's over there looking in the window. So I'm going to do that. Remove that. And, you know, that's our life. That's what goes on here. Other than that, you know, I'm trying to get him to write so that people can see that he's using his own hands to write, but we haven't gotten very far with that. Well, of course he has. We had conversations about why he had to stay in there. When the pens were built, because it wasn't always like that. Bo was actually with us everywhere. He went with us to New Hampshire. There are any number of videos where you can see that he's outside in the big wide world. But at a certain point, it became really clear that for his own safety, he had to stay inside, or he was gonna get in trouble with people and with the authorities. And that's why we did it, for his own safety. Because, if he were out there wandering around, as an adult male chimpanzee, I don't think that society is ready for that right now. So we're not going to give it a try, because we want to keep him safe. We don't want him shot. But yeah, we've talked about it. And there were times, when he kind of got away and was wandering around in the house. And I told him, Bo, if you go out the door, I can't be responsible for what will happen. The police could come and shoot you. And the doorbell rang, and he jumped into my arms and let me put him back in the pen, because he does understand. And that was when he was young enough to jump into my arms. He knows, he knows. And you have to understand, he is stronger than me by much. If he wanted to overpower me and take my keys and leave, he could. But he's not doing that. He's abiding by the rules, because he does understand now. It hurt him a lot when he was little, when I decided that that was the best thing. But right now, it's not a problem any longer. He understands. I'm still thinking about ways of architecturally modifying our space so that he can have, more of a place to roam, and more of a natural place to roam. But at the moment, we don't have funding for that either. He's older. Yeah, well, we're both older. I'm a lot older than I was when we started this too. And my daughter Sword is older. So yeah, we're all older. But he's just a young man. I wonder if I could share with you on the other screen some of the other videos of him when he was little. Funny why it's so hard to get to your own playlists. They keep wanting to sell you playlists for other people. But so I could play you some of the cross posture ones. let me silence that and see if I can just share the video without the ad. So this is a video of Bo on his first day with us, and this is Sword. She was 2.5 years old at the time. I don't think it would be cool, Derek, to see him in a sanctuary. I don't think you understand. It would not be cool at all. You saw that one, yeah. She wanted to hold him. Yeah, those were wonderful times. So Sword had her dolls positioned in various places in the room, and Bo was already crawling now at this point. You can see that's quite a lot of development. Sword wanted me to sit next to her. And she wants Bo to sit there too, but Bo wanted to crawl around. And he always wanted to be next to Sword, and he wanted to do what she was doing. But she was kind of bossy, and she... he wanted to play dolls, too. But wanted to be in the middle of things. Okay, I didn't want that. Okay, now we can maybe share that again. Really. This is Beau's first Christmas. You see how much he's grown. You saw that one too. Yeah. Well, those are some of the best ones from that period. Yeah, and he does remember all of that. At that time he had a little bit of a cold, you know. So when he gets a cold, you know, when we get a cold, he gets a cold too. He got over it pretty fast, but this is why he knows how to blow his nose. He's had lots of practice with it. Okay, that was our trip to New Hampshire. Yeah, Bo was afraid of the water. But he really enjoyed climbing high. I don't know if you can see that there. At this point, we had alexograms on the glass. So you see all those white things on the glass? Those are words that he could use. You can see that he had access to a lot of land, a lot of space. And as long as he was little, there was no problem going there, driving there with him in his little infant seat. And as soon as we left, he wanted to go with us, so there was no problem getting him to come home. But he was very attached to Sword, and he felt like it was his job to keep her close to me you know, to not go too far away. So if she wanted to go someplace, you know, he would come and get her. He keeps coming and getting her. He doesn't want her to go far. And see? Big hug. Well, I think we all civilize our children, Derek. You know, Beau wants everybody to know that he's good. He told me that. He asked me not to ever say anything bad about him because he wants people to know that he's good. No, he's not trying to be dominant. He's just trying to make sure that she's okay. At that point in his life, he didn't want to. He would keep a radius that was pretty small. He would go a circle around me. He didn't want her to get lost. It was a vast area that she could have wandered in, and he was always bringing her back whenever she went, in his opinion, too far. She Sword is explaining here that she's pretending to be somebody who's running away from home, and Beau is responsible for her. So they're playing this game where she's a little girl and he's taking care of her. Whenever she runs off, he comes and gets her. Yeah, well, there's a difference, but he shows deference is what he does. Yes, you can watch these at your leisure. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I don't really know that this one is that much about Beau, so. Okay. See all those words over there. There are words on the glass. Because he's taking him to the post office. He's a package. Okay, no, she's going to be the package and he's going to bring her to the post office. Yeah, they both had a really great time. And she's got summer in her hand. Can you see summer? Okay, this is from earlier. Yeah, so maybe I should stop sharing at this point. That was delight that we were looking at. Okay. So, I mean, there are lots of playlists and you could watch all of them at your leisure, just as one of you said. And there are other playlists that are specifically about the language development. And you can see how we went from lexigrams, pointing at lexigrams, to the time when he started actually pointing at letters and spelling out words. And the only real question is, how do we go about proving that? How can he do that without holding somebody's hand and using it as a pointer? And what I'm hoping to do is to get him to write with a pen, a pencil, whether it's on an iPad or just on a piece of paper. I've just found that all of the electronic things that were supposed to work so well, they don't work well. He gets very distracted by the other functions. So way back when we were doing lexigrams, he would be more interested in changing from one page to the next and hearing the recorded voice say next page or something along those lines than he was interested in hearing the sound of the word. We have a self-flushing toilet that we never really use because it's too distracting and it's much easier to use the potty. We ended up using lexigrams. I think for Bo, using low-tech means of expressing himself is just more realistic than having him use a computer to do so. What sound? I mean, there was a device that we had that was supposed to sound outwards. We had menus for him to use on the device, but instead of being interested in the actual words, he liked the sounds of going from one page to the next. I'm not sure what you're talking about, but Well, they're both children at that point, and they were both playing each in a slightly different way. Sword enjoyed pretending a lot. Wonder if there's a different playlist that maybe I should be sharing with you, but I could just show you also the standards of proof article, and we could share that. So let me see if I can do this. So this is a different kind of share. Okay, so at this point we're looking at my article standards of proof, and you can see that on my ResearchGate, if you're interested. Okay. So, standards of proof in language and ape language studies, the case of Bowen literacy. And here's the abstract. Objective evidence of spontaneous contextual use of language in ape language studies requires replicable results, significant samples, statistical analysis, and double-blind testing. If the results are replicable and predictable, then the accusation of rote training can be leveled. If the evidence arises spontaneously in context, then it may be merely anecdotal. The requirements create insurmountable difficulties where proof is concerned. This paper offers evidence that Bo, a male common chimpanzee, is the author of his own messages through the following circumstances. One, Bo spells out information not known to his interlocutor. Two, Bo spells out in Hebrew with an interlocutor who is not a Hebrew speaker when there is no Hebrew speaker present. A new test for substantiating evidence of language use is suggested, namely, that if no other reasonable explanation for language output by a non-human is available, then the use of language is established. And the keywords are ape language studies, chimpanzees, Hebrew, English, apes and literacy, standards of proof, bilingualism in non-humans, bilingualism as a method of double blind testing. And of course, I'm not going to read you the entire okay, what is it that you're searching for, Derek? I just searched it. The first three results were inaccurate, and this YouTube was subsequently closed without my action. What was that? I'm not sure. What is the website? Okay, I'll give you the website. But it's also in the description. So I put it in the chat, but the website is also in the description. It should be in the description right below. Yeah, that's the website. It's my ResearchGate where you can read a lot of my articles. Okay. All right. So does anybody else have any other comments or questions? If not, I think we pretty much covered everything. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to share with you the two videos that we saw at the beginning. One of them was about the citations of my work from this week. And the second one was just interacting with Bo and other animals on my farm. And then we can say goodbye. All right. So, yeah, that was... These were the two citations. The first one was with regard to the copula cycle. And it's quite interesting. These people have written an article about ASL and the sign for self. And the sign for self has developed into a copula. So that was the one thing that was citing my work. And... The other one was this bizarre, ResearchGate told me about it, that there was something about Coco being an imposter on Big Think and that they were citing my standards of proof in ape language studies. So now I'm going to just share with you instead what we started out with Bo. Just highlights from tonight, for this week.
My borders are gathered.
I'd also like to say thank you to our members, Sofia Slime ASMR, Sparrow 13. Oh my goodness, I better respell that. Sparrow 13 and Jenna H. All right, everybody. I'd like to say thanks to Sparrow 13, Sophia Slime ASMR, and Jenna H. Good night. Good night, everyone.